Amen. Praise the Lord. What's good to have Gumo here? Gumo's good to see you, my brother. Everybody's been asking, where's Gumo? Where's Gumo? So it's good to see Gumo here. He's a man of many travels. God has blessed him. He's been traveling. Everybody, it's good everywhere. It's good to see you, brother. It's good to have you here worshiping with us today. Amen. Well, the last few weeks we've been talking about the power of the will. And we read in Joshua, if you'll give me a few minutes here this morning, we read in Joshua and we declared, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Can y'all make that declaration with me this morning? Come on, say it. As for me and my house, what? Everybody say it. We will serve the Lord. Amen? And this is a powerful corporate declaration of faith over his house for Joshua. When Joshua made this declaration, it was such a powerful declaration of faith. And we should all make this declaration over our families that we will serve the Lord. But then we talked about the personal side. The personal side, not just of the will, because you will never be successful with the we will declaration without making the declaration of I will. Everybody say it with me, I will. So we will is corporate. I will is personal. I will. I will get through this. I will get up. I will make it. Come on, you know what I'm talking about? That's personal. I will trust God. That's a personal declaration. You know, sometimes that's the toughest thing to do. See, you can direct someone else what to do with we will. You can direct your family, you can say we will, but when you say I will, then you are challenged to practice what you preach. When you say I will serve the Lord. And so we talked about that last week, and I challenged you last week, I preached a message on I will overcome. And so this morning, I've come to challenge you and declare over your life, and I want you to repeat it with me, I will not give up. Come on, say it with me. I will not give up. Come on, Brother Reds already preached half of that message this morning. Come on, he's helping me. Come on, declare, I will not give up. What a mighty testimony of not giving up. From a man who I just met this morning, he said, I was a crack addict for 20-something years. And when I came into the church, I was still struggling, but I would not give up. There's a power in the human spirit not to give up. The most successful people in the world are those who don't give up. And there's something that God has deposited in the human spirit that pushes a man and a woman not to give up. Something that tells him to get up when he's been knocked down. You hardly see anybody when they get knocked down just stay down. Most people, if they're still conscious, the first thing they do is try to get up. Are you hearing me? And most of the time, if somebody gets knocked down, the ambulance, somebody comes and say, no, no, sir, you need to stay down, because the most, you know, it's safe for them to stay down. They don't know what's going on, but it's in human nature to get up. It's in human nature not to stay down. The Bible says in Galatians 6:9, let us not become weary in doing good. For in proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Are y'all with me? Come on, I hope y'all came to church, because let me read that again. Let us not become weary in doing good. Listen, I don't know about you, but there's some times when I don't feel like doing good to people when they do bad to me. Oh, are y'all with me? When people do me bad, guess what? It's also my human nature to do bad back to them. Is that just me? Or y'all being a little extra Christian this morning? Am I the only one being real? But when somebody does bad to me, I want to do bad to them. When I'm driving now 45 and somebody cuts me off and gives a national signal to me of hello, I want to give it right back. Sometimes my window comes down, my arm comes off the steering wheel, and I got to stop myself. I say, I will not. I hear my wife say, Pastor? And I say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. But it's human. It says, let us not grow weary in doing good. Watch this. For in proper time, give up. The scripture tells us that if we don't give up on what we're doing, when we know to do what is right, we will see the reward of it. It may not happen today, it may not happen tomorrow, but if you keep sowing good, eventually good is going to come back to you. It's a human nature, it's a nature of the universe, it's God's nature. Hello? For example, when a farmer takes some time to plant seeds and in a properly plowed field, what happened? It doesn't produce immediately. He waits, he has to wait for the rain, and has to wait for the sun, and has to wait for the weather to be right, has to wait for the seed to mature. But when it's the proper time, and when the harvest arrives, it's what he sowed that grows. It's not what he didn't sow. What he sowed grows at the right time. And it's actually, and what he reaps is actually several measures more than what he sowed. That's what the Bible says. You're going to reap more than you sow. You're going to get houses you didn't build and stuff you didn't plant. You didn't have to work for. Why? Because God said it's in your sowing. But we have to keep sowing good, wait patiently, make wise decisions, and don't give up, and we'll see the results. Amen? Come on. Are y'all with me this morning? Sometimes we become frustrated. Let's tell the truth. We become frustrated when things don't happen the way we expect them to happen. That's a natural reaction. But trusting God is not about him doing it the way we want him to do it. It's about his will, not our will. Because many times God doesn't do things the way we want them done. That's the truth. Listen, if God did things the way I wanted them done, I wouldn't be here this morning. Somebody tell the truth. If God did things the way I wanted them done, I wouldn't have the wife I have today. I would have been married a long time ago and probably divorced 2 or 3 times. But thank God I didn't give up. Hello? That old saying, good things come to those who wait. Are you hearing? Why? You have to trust God that when they don't work out the way we planned it, that at the end of the day, if we trust God, we're going to reap if we keep doing what we know is right. Are y'all with me? Jesus said he prayed in the garden as we're nearing the Easter season. While we're here in the Easter season, he prayed in the garden right before he was taken. He said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. He said, Lord, it's your will. Pass this cup from me. But not my will, thy will. We've been talking about this, that one of the greatest battles that we have to face as children of God is the battle between our will and his will. I know my will. We know what we want. The hard part is we don't know what God wants. And sometimes when God's will shows up, it doesn't look like what we want. See, his will isn't always going to look like our will. Now look at how Mary, and it's exemplified in the story of Mary and Martha, how they reacted when Lazarus died. Remember when Lazarus died? When Lazarus died, Martha was mad. She was mad at Jesus because Jesus didn't come when she thought he ought to come. Jesus was late to the party. He was late. Matter of fact, when he showed up, Martha told Jesus, she turned around and told Jesus, if you would have been here, my brother would have died. Look at that. Do you see how mad she was? She said, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't be dead. So she knew that Jesus had the power of life, but she limited the power to him being there after life was gone. What she didn't know is Jesus didn't have power, didn't just have the power over life, but he had the power over death as well. In other words, just because something dies in your life doesn't mean life is over. It doesn't, death doesn't have the last word. The Bible says that Jesus rose 3 days later and is sitting at the right hand of the Father. Are you? I know it's not Easter Sunday yet, but I came to tell you Martha said, if you would have been here, my brother would have died. Now she's getting mad. Now she's starting to get bitter. Watch. Instead of saying, oh, thank you, Jesus, for coming. Thank you, Lord, for being here. She got bitter and blamed him for the death of her brother. If you would have been here. Watch. I want you to hear me when I tell you this. Be careful. Be careful. Because bitter people will always blame other people for their problems. Oh, come on. How many of you know some bitter people? Bitter people always blame others for their problems. It wasn't Jesus' fault that Lazarus got sick, but yes, she said, if you would have been here, he wouldn't have died. She said, well, I didn't make him sick. But she was so bitter at the situation that she blamed Jesus. She blamed the solution. Watch. It wasn't his fault he died, but when life didn't turn out the way they expected it, they blamed Jesus. It's your fault we're in this position. See, I can imagine all the emotions. My brother served you, Jesus. He believed in you, and you let him die. That's why it's so important that our motives be right. Watch this. People whose motives aren't right give up when they feel God didn't give them what they expected to get. But when your motive is right, because listen, it's easy to get bitter when life doesn't match up the expectation of your faith. I want you to know this. Many times life will not match up with the expectation of your faith. But it's not because your faith failed you. It's because God has something else for you. I've learned that a long time ago. There are many people who have given up because life didn't match what they expected from God. Can we talk about it this morning? It's happened to the best of us. When life doesn't match up to the expectation. Be careful that bitterness doesn't set in when life doesn't match up with your faith expectation. I've been there. I've been mad at God before. Can we tell the truth? I may have ever gotten mad. Lord, but you said. God, but you promised. Lord, but the Bible says. God, but I'm a tither. Uh-oh. But I serve. But I'm an usher. I'm in children ministry. But I do this. I do all this. And then I get this. And the next thing that comes in your spirit is forget it. I'll just go back. But I'm here to tell you, that's why you have to have an I will not give up spirit. Because can I tell you that anything you don't give up on, God can resurrect. Are y'all with me? Watch. I want to give you three places in scripture where people could have given up, but they decided to keep pushing forward for God to show up for them. Watch this. Mark chapter 10. The first thing, the first principle of not giving up is say it. Everybody say it. Come on, say it after me. Say it. That's hard to pronounce, huh? I want you to say it. Not say it. You got to say the whole phrase. Say it. The first principle is you got to say it. Come on, say it. I knew that was going to be a tongue twister for us. Mark chapter 10, verse 46. And they came to Jericho, and Jesus and his disciples together with a large crowd were leaving the city, and a blind man named Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus, he began to shout. He began to what? He began to say it. He began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted even more, son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And so they called the blind man. Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked. The blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. He said, go. He said, Jesus, your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. Now watch. The story of the blind Bartimaeus is one full of unfortunate circumstances. The Bible doesn't say much about his history. It just says that he was a son of Timaeus. This is important because from this, most Bible scholars believe that Bartimaeus was blind because he inherited it from his father. Son of Timaeus means that he was a son of a blind man. So Bartimaeus was born blind as an inherited blindness from his father. He was born in this condition. You talk about being bitter or the opportunity to be mad. I didn't do nothing to get blind. Why did I deserve this? Watch. Even what? And scholars believe when you read this, you learn that even the curbside where he was sitting was inherited from his father. He was sitting on the same curb that his dad sat and begged every day. So not only was his blindness came from his father, but his position in the city came from his father. He inherited his dad's job. Hello? That's why you got to get up every day and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Because your children will become who you are. Oh, I know you don't want to hear it. Watch. It was the same curve. Now watch. And so blind Bartimaeus had been begging since he was a child. He was raised in this. Now watch. But when Jesus showed up, he didn't sit back. He could have sat back in what he was used to. He could have sat there and said, oh, I'm used to begging. Blind Bartimaeus could have just sat there and just kept on begging. Why? Because that's what he was used to. But when Jesus showed up, he didn't sit back. He didn't give up and settle for where he was. The Bible says that he jumped on his feet and started shouting, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Now, how do you suppose he knew who Jesus was? He didn't read about it. You know how? I believe that as he was sitting there begging, alms, help, he would hear the people walking by. Did you hear about that guy named Jesus? And he would hear it. He couldn't see it. He never saw him do one miracle. But he would hear, did you hear about that guy who walked on water? They say he's a son of God. They say he's a son of David. And there he was, jingling-a-ling. Throw me a little down. Would you help me, please? Help a blind man. Would you help? They say he's a son of God. Did you hear what he said? That man said he's gonna die and he's gonna raise 3 days later. But there was the blind man. Had nothing left. Everybody else was talking doubt. All he was hearing was hope. Will you hear me? And he walked by, and the moment, I can imagine that afternoon, chaos, something was going on, something different. Everybody was running by, walking by. He's coming, he's coming, he's coming. Here he comes, the guy, here he comes, here he comes. And all he was, he heard, who's coming? He was just saying, hey, what's going on? Who's coming? Hey, what's going on? So, Jesus is coming. Sit there. You just sit on that curb. Don't get in anybody's way, but Jesus is coming. And he could have sat there and given up in his blind situation. But the Bible says the first opportunity he got, he put down his little begging can. He set aside the little trust that he had. And he said, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. He didn't even know if Jesus was in hearing voice. He didn't know if Jesus, where Jesus was. But he used what he had and he said it. Thought about this. He could have taken his cup and said, Jesus, do you have a coin? Lord, can I get a little help? I hear you walk on water, but can you give me a dollar? No. He didn't limit God to his present condition. He didn't limit God to his present of what his present need. He said, if he can walk on water, I don't need this cup anymore. Lord, Why ask him for a dollar when he can give me the ability to do it myself? And the Bible says, watch, the Bible doesn't say that Jesus saw him. Jesus heard him. Never saw him. Everybody else was showing Jesus their sickness. But this man had the faith not to give up in his limitation, but he shouted Jesus. And the Bible says that when Jesus heard him, he stopped, looked around and said, bring him to me. Who? The guy calling my name. When was the last time you said it? See, we're seeing a lot of things. We're seeing a lot of things. Man, I'm broke. Man, look at all the stuff I'm going through. We're declaring every bad thing about in our life. We talk about our problems, honey, and we don't have a problem talking about our problems. Matter of fact, we talk about our problems so much we put it on Facebook. We'll tell the whole world about our problem. Man, I had a hard day today. Woo! We call everybody. We call all of our friends. We tell everybody what's going on. We tell everybody. But watch it. When was the last time we declared Jesus? Have mercy! Now, can I tell you something? Your condition doesn't move God. If condition moved God, there would be no hungry people or sick people in the world. Watch. It wasn't his condition that stopped him in his tracks. It was his declaration. It was what he said. It was when he said, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy. He didn't say, if you would have been here, Jesus, I would have been blind. He said, Lord, I don't care when you showed up, but the fact that you're here now tells me you can do it right now. Have mercy! I don't care when you showed up to church, but the fact that you showed up, God can do it right now. Have mercy! Some of you are so busy talking about how bad your life is that you haven't stopped to declare, have mercy on me, God. And recognize who he is. Some of you need to change what you're saying and start shouting, I will not give up, because I still serve a God who got up. Don't give up. The greatest thing you can do is open your mouth and say, are y'all with me? Hello, I could stay there all day, but I gotta move on. The second thing, the first thing he said, say it. The second thing is see it. Now watch this. Luke chapter 8, verse 43 through 48. I'm trying to wrap this up. Y'all give me a couple more minutes. And now a woman having an issue of blood for 12 years, who had spent her livelihood in physicians and they could not be healed by any, came from behind and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her flow of blood stopped. And when Jesus turned around and said, who touched me? When all denied it, Peter and those who with him said, Master, multiple people throng you and press you and touch you. You say, who touched me? But Jesus said, somebody touched me, for I preserve power has gone out from me. And when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and fell before him and declared to him the presence of the Almighty, declared to him and in the presence of all the people the reason why she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. And he said to her, daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith has made you well. Go in peace. This woman amazes me. I love this woman. She amazes me. She's different from Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus was called out by Jesus. Watch, but not this woman. Jesus said, bring him to me. This woman didn't wait for an audience. She didn't wait for Jesus to draw attention. She didn't wait for the pastor to recognize she was in service and say, "Hi, how are you doing? It's good to have you." Oh, the pastor didn't say hi to me. I'm not going to that church no more. I went to church. I was there. Pastor Bob didn't even say hi. Why do you want to? It's important that I say hi to you. Really? You came here for me? Son, you came for the wrong reason. I wouldn't come here for me. I don't know about you, but I came to see Jesus. I came to the presence of God. Are you hearing me? Watch. Bartimaeus was called out by Jesus, not this woman. Jesus, matter of fact, the Bible says Jesus didn't even know she was there. This woman was desperate. She was desperate for healing. She had suffered a long time. She didn't wait for Jesus to see her or hear her. As soon as she saw the opportunity, she touched him. Watch. While everyone else was hoping he would speak to them, she put herself in a position to touch him. She said, "If I could just touch his garment." Now watch this. Watch. The amazing thing is, she didn't even touch him. She touched what was touching him. Y'all don't know, but that's why some of y'all came to church this morning. Y'all said, some of y'all can't touch him, but if I could just touch what's touching him, if I can get in a place, I don't know how to worship, but if I can stand where they're worshiping him, then maybe what's on them can lead on to me. Y'all, I need about 10 people up here. Come on, Pastor. Y'all come and help. Just come on. Come on, brother. Come on. Alex, come up here. Come here. Brother Daniel, come up here. Watch. Y'all stand right here. Brother Daniel, you stand there and face that way. You face that way. Watch. Y'all get it. Y'all crowd up behind him. Watch. Y'all crowd up behind Daniel. Brother Daniel, no, make a crowd. Not a line. A crowd. Y'all get. You make a crowd. There you go. There you go. Right there. Come on, brother. Come on. That's Daniel is Jesus. Now watch. Y'all face that way. But y'all around him. Watch. There you go. Just stand right there. Here comes this woman. And here's the problem. She had something between her and Jesus. See, walking, it wasn't as easy as going, "Hey, Jesus." No. She had obstacles. She had some big old biker guys. She could have come out here and said, "Oh, no, I'll never make it. I'll never, brother, come on, I'm about to wrap keyboards. I'll never make it. I can't." She could have stood up. She could have given up right here. She was sick. She could have given up right here. Can I make this more fun, more interesting? Watch. She had it. Watch. Can I borrow that? Here she comes. Woo! Lord Jesus. Here she comes with her issue. "I'll never get to him. I'm not worthy. Seriously, I see him. But I'll never make it." Have you ever felt like that? You needed God so bad, but you thought you could never, you were so unworthy to reach your watch. But watch her faith. She had held on to this and said, "I'll never make it. But I'm not giving up. I can't take this with me, so I won't take it." She got between, watch her. All the religious people were in the way. My God, night. The church people, the deacons, the elders, the pastor, they even looked at her. They probably turned around and looked at her and said, "Mammy, stop off. Go over there. Don't bother Jesus." But you know what she did? She just went to the crowd and said, Excuse me. I didn't come to see you, I came to see Jesus. Excuse me. She pressed away. Excuse me. And when they were trying, she just says, at the last she reached him, "I don't even want to bother him. If I could just touch him." Lord.
And the Bible says, when she touched the hem of his garment, she came in hot. When she touched him, she walked out. Now faith is a substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. To see it means you gotta have faith for it. She saw Jesus. He didn't see her, but she saw him. All you have to do is see yourself getting out of it.
The food will still be warm when you get there.
Say it. See it.
Number three, pray for it. Say it. See it. Pray for it. See, there's a difference between saying it and praying for it. Saying it is a declaration. I will not give up. Praying for it is saying, Lord, help me not to give up. Now hear me. Luke 18, 1 through 8. And Jesus told the disciples a parable saying to them, they should always pray and not give up. My God, that's how many times did Jesus say, don't give up? How many times did he say it? Don't give up. Why did he say it? Because he knew there was times we were going to want to give up. Yeah. Doing good, for you'll reap if you don't give up. And then he says, you should always pray and not give up. In other words, we can't do something spiritual and not make a decision. We have to do the spiritual thing and make a decision at the same time. Pray and not give up. Do good and not give up. The praying and the doing good, that's the spiritual side. The not giving give up when I was in the world. When I was in the world, I didn't give up. Robert reminded me of something. He called me, he texted me, he said, what's up, Magic Mondo? Man, I ain't heard that nickname. Magic Mondo was out before Magic Mike was out, all right? I know I got the vest on this morning, too. But they called me Magic Mondo back in the 90s. I won't tell you why, because I was here and I was gone. Boy, y'all don't know about Magic. Because they said, man, I did some crazy stuff when I was stoned. They call me Magic. Nah. But that's the old me. But you know what? The old me didn't give up. When I was in the world, I didn't give up. I didn't back down from a fight. We didn't give up. All of a sudden, we become Christians, and we give up. When back then, we had a reason to give up. Now, we have a reason not to give up. I can't give up. What? Where else shall I go? I have nothing to go back to. Nothing. The other day I went, one of my biker friends who hangs out with a club that's not Christian, and they drink and do all that, and they do party and they do all this stuff, right? He invited, hey, we're having this, so I rolled out there and I said, out of respect, you know, I'll go hang out with them, go talk to them, have my bottle of water, and I was sitting there and I ran into people I ain't seen in a long time. They were like, man, you still in church? I'm like, yeah, bro, I'm a pastor, I'm here, but everything's good. You know, and I was there talking to them, and they were like, man, I'm going to start going, man, I know I haven't been in church, and they're telling me, hey, they get convicted as soon as I walk around for some reason, as soon as I come by. I'm not Jesus, bro. Don't touch me. You ain't even done. You know? So, and I looked at that atmosphere, and I said, why would I want to go back to this? Having a good time, but I was standing there going, this don't move me no more. I got a greater purpose. I got a greater hope. There was a time when that entertained me, but now there's something bigger inside. I can't stay out of his word too long. I can't not worship. I can't be away from his presence for too long, because when I'm away too long, I miss him. I want his presence. When the life throws its best punch at me, I used to just get mad and cuss it out, but now I ain't gonna lie, sometimes I do still get mad and I pray for me. I say, Lord, my righteousness is like dirty rags. I need you. You're the same God that saved me from my sin. I need you. I will not give up. Take me. You know what I found out about God? Is that no matter how far low I fall, he's always right there to pick me back up. And he's a good father. Oh, you can't run far enough to get away from him. You can't sin far enough for him to give up on you. He loves you just the way you are, and he's there for you. I came to tell somebody this morning, whatever you're going through, don't give up. Whatever you're facing, don't give up. Whatever's hitting your life, don't give up. God has got something bigger. Lord, I think this putting on this vest made me preach better. Come on, son. Lift your hands to the Lord this morning. I don't know what you're going through, brother. Sister, I don't know what you're going through. But I want you to open your mouth and say it. I will not give up. Come on, turn around and look at your wife and your husband and say, we will not give up. The devil is a liar. Come on. Now look at the Lord. Lift your hands and just look at him and say, I will not give up. And begin to open your mouth and declare what you're believing God to do. Come on, say it this morning. I need some of y'all to say it. Say it. Open your mouth. Somebody, if that's all you can say, have mercy on me. And say that. If that's